does work. Great. Thank you all very much for coming this evening. As was just mentioned, the event this evening is in conjunction with a special issue of the journal Daedalus, which just came out about a week or so ago. It's an issue that has 15 contributions about China and is entitled Growing Pains in a Rising China. It's a group of interdisciplinary social scientists, political scientists, economists, sociologists, anthropologists, historians who have contributed to the issue. And three of them are with us this evening on the panel. There's also at least one other in the audience. So let me first actually recognize in the audience Marty White over there, my colleague at Harvard, who has a piece in the issue on social inequality. I don't know if there are any of the other authors in the audience this evening, but if not, let me mention the three panelists, and then I'll make just a few introductory remarks and turn things over to them for about 10 minutes apiece to get things started, and then we'll open up to questions and answers after that. The three panelists this evening, on my far right there, is Barry Naughton, who is an economist at the University of California at San Diego. In the middle here is Ben Liebman, who is in the law school at Columbia University. And next to me is Ching-Kwan Lee, professor of sociology at UCLA. And there are extensive biographies, bios of each of them, each of whom has a very distinguished biography, and I'll let you read those at your leisure. I'd also like to very much express my appreciation to Phyllis Bendall, standing at the top of the stairs there, who is the director of publications here at the Academy, who suggested this special issue and made it so painless for all of us. Thank you very much. The special issue, as I mentioned, is entitled Growing Pains in a Rising China. And that title was chosen to underscore the tremendous challenges and contradictions that China currently faces on so many fronts, while at the same time suggesting that these tensions may perhaps be better understood as growing pains of a body politic that is still in the process of changing and maturing, rather than necessarily the death pangs of a communist dinosaur destined to imminent extinction. It's already, I think, fulfilled the category of distinction. And extinction may come, but perhaps not immediately. The special issue, the contents of which you may be able to see there up on the screen, deals with challenges that face China after 35 years of reform efforts. It attempts to take stock of China's challenges on a wide range of issues: demographic, healthcare, welfare, labor, how the internet is affecting China, religious diversity in contemporary China, higher education, local governance, China's involvement in globalization trends, and the environmental pollution of China, as well as the issues of the economy, legal reform, and social protests that our three panelists will be speaking about tonight. Taking stock of these issues and the question of how well China is or isn't doing on any of these fronts is not by any means an easy task. For one thing, the head-spinning pace of change in China threatens to render any of our academic assessments quickly obsolete. For another, the PRC's post-Mao record of achievement is decidedly uneven. It's uneven across geographic regions, it's uneven across social strata, and it's uneven among the different policy sectors that we'll be considering. The major cities of China boast gleaming infrastructure and urban amenities that equal or in some cases surpass those to be found in the advanced industrial world, but much of the rural interior remains mired in grinding poverty. And in the interior covers of this Daedalus issue, we have a couple of photographs intended to exemplify, if I can get it up here, these contrasts. First, a rural village, a very poor village in the center of China, and then a rather different scene in Beijing. And the theme of many of these 15 essays in Daedalus is the contrast between these two very, very different Chinas. The affluence of new urban middle and upper classes who are flush with the proceeds from lucrative real estate deals is offset by the indigence of millions of rural dwellers and millions of migrants who labor in the midst of urban affluence. And although the Chinese state can take a good deal of credit, at least through the 1990s, for spearheading a series of bold economic measures that have replenished central coffers and have enriched many citizens, post-Mao achievements in the realm of social welfare, not to mention political and legal reform, have to date been a good deal less impressive. Despite its many very serious problems, however, the post-Mao Chinese state has survived, and indeed by many measures thrived, for too long now not to be taken seriously as a subject for comparative policy investigation. Moreover, the historical origins of the PRC suggest that its future may not be well predicted by the fates of the former Soviet Union and East European communist regimes. The PRC, like the four other remaining communist regimes, ascended to power via an extended rural revolution that endowed the state and its ruling Communist Party with strong nationalist credentials. This stands in contrast to the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, which gained control through a relatively short and quite narrowly based urban revolution. And the difference with Eastern Europe, where communist regimes were generally imposed by Soviet military might at the end of the Second World War, is even sharper. Unlike most of the formerly communist world, the PRC and its fellow surviving communist states attained power in the course of prolonged and pervasive peasant mobilization. That rich revolutionary history bequeathed valuable practical experience in social organization and control, while bestowing important political advantages that so far have withstood the test of time. This is certainly not to imply that these regimes are destined to last forever, far from it, but whatever the lifespan of the PRC turns out to be, its remarkable rise and resilience to date suggests that I think we should take quite seriously its efforts to resolve its current challenges. So in this special issue of Daedalus, the contributors were invited to explore ways in which the Chinese state is addressing actual policy concerns, from protest to public health. Although these problems may be especially pronounced and politically sensitive in China, in light of China's exceptional size, its rapid economic growth under a basically unreformed Leninist political system, there are also problems that are common to virtually all countries. And so authors were encouraged to assess the Chinese state's record in comparative context, highlighting what is unique or unusual, for better or worse, in the PRC's efforts to resolve these universal dilemmas. Thinking comparatively about global dilemmas is of more than academic interest. We live today in a fragile and yet highly interdependent world that is troubled by a range of transnational challenges, from pandemics and climate change to financial meltdowns and terrorism. Institutions of governance that are as different as the Chinese Communist Politburo and the US Congress find themselves severely tested, both ideologically and operationally, in trying to address these issues. And we would, I think, be foolhardy to disregard or to discount China's efforts to resolve its serious problems simply because we predict that its political system is someday destined to disappear. So let me turn now to the panelists, and I will turn first to Barry Naughton to give us a sense of economic change and perhaps his ideas about future prospects for the Chinese economy.